الحمد لله صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبيه ومصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه من تبعه وله وسلم تسليم الكثيرة. All praises due to Allah. Blessings be upon His chosen and last messenger and prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. We continue inshallah our second session of Fiqh of Hajj. Fiqh of Hajj. Last week we talked about the status of Hajj, the importance of Hajj, the ability as a condition to do Hajj. We talked about conditions of Hajj, Islam, reaching puberty, freedom, and ability. And we talked about ability as financial ability and physical ability as well. We talked about the ability of the woman is to have a mahram with her or to have a trustworthy company of women to go with the different. And then we talked about being free from debts and all of that to go for Hajj as well as part of the ability as well. Today, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, we talk about the Hajj of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we talk about the hadith of Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, one of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the Sahaba who narrated plenty of the hadith. There are few Sahaba who narrated majority of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Amr, Aisha radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Jabir ibn Abdullah. These few here, they are the ones who narrated the majority of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Huraira is number one. But Jabir ibn Abdullah is one of those mukthirin as well, those who narrated. And his narration in the Hajj is the main narration, because he described the Hajj of Rasulullah from the time he intended it until the time he go back to Medina. From the time Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I'm making Hajj, all the way he went to Hajj, how many people went, and he described many things, as you'll see in a minute, until he finished the Hajj sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he came back. Yes, sir. Yeah. Sisters, please come forward, inshallah, if you want. They always come in the side here, and they can sit on the right side. No problem, inshallah, our sisters. Absolutely, jazakallah khair. So sisters, inshallah, if you want to join, please come in the main prayer hall. So Jabir ibn Abdullah described the Hajj of Rasulullah, and any book talking about the rules of Hajj, you're going to find this hadith. For sure, for sure you find this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam described by Jabir. And this is in Sahih Muslim. This is in Sahih al-Imam Muslim. The book of Sahih Muslim, like Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, he described this hadith. So let's get right into the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Muslim narrates with his chain that one of the grandchildren of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he entered the house of Jabir ibn Abdullah. Right? So he's from Tabi'in, one of the great grandchildren of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He is narrating the hadith, that narrating Sahih Muslim, he said, we entered the house of Jabir ibn Abdullah. فَسَأَلَ عَنِ الْقَوْمِ حَتَّى انْتَهَى إِلَيَّ. So he asked, who are the people? He was older man at that time. Jabir ibn Abdullah, Sahabi of Rasulullah, was a young man at the time of the Prophet. But then the Prophet passed away, and people visit him to learn about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ask who's this, until he reached this narrative of the hadith, and he said, who are you? He said, Ana Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Hussein. I am Muhammad, the son of Ali, the son of Hussein, the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib. You see this great grandson of Ali ibn Abi Talib. So he put his hand in his head and he talked to him, and he said, at that time I was a young man, I was young. فَقَالَ مَرْحَبًا بِكَ يَا ابْنَ أَخِي. Welcome to you, my nephew. Ask me whatever you like. And this here, inshallah, I'm going to comment lightly on the part in certain parts of the hadith. طبعا, this hadith, there are books, volumes written about it. yani this specific hadith, volumes written about it, about the rules from fiqh perspective, you know, do's and don'ts and all that. From adab, adab, you know, the adab means like etiquette of asking, relationships, community. This hadith has everything in it. So I'm going to speak lightly about that. So here, how an older scholar, the Sahabi of Rasulullah, is honoring a younger man because he is from the offspring of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. How a teacher honors a student who is eager to learn, he tell him, ask me any question you want. Alright? And this is adab as well. فَسَأَلْتُهُ وَهُوَ أَعْمَى. So he said, I asked him, and his eyes were blind. He was blind by that time. Jabir ibn Abdullah was blind at that time. وَحَضَرَ وَقْتُ الصَّلَاةِ وَقْتُ الصَّلَاةِ. Time of Salah came. He did not say which Salah, but he said the time of Salah came. فَقَامَ فِي نَسَاجَةٍ مُلْتَحِفًا بِهَا. A cloak or a piece of blanket or cloth that he was covering himself with. كلما وضعها على منكبه رجع طرفها إليه من صغره. Every time he put it on his shoulder, it goes back because it's small. He's describing the state of the Sahabi of Rasulullah. He's not that rich or wealthy. وصلى بنا رداه إلى جنبه. And his other clothes were over there on the hanger. He said فصلى بنا. He led us in the salah. فقلت. That means the grandson of Hussein, you know, Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Hussein. He is asking Jabir ibn Abdullah. He said, I come to ask you about the Hajj of Rasulullah. And here is one thing I want to mention. Who is who's Rasulullah for this man? Grandfather. Yet he is not saying, I am from the family of the Prophet, I don't need the knowledge from anybody. You see my point here? Still, even though his great-grandfather is the Rasul himself, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but the knowledge that of his great-grandfather of Rasulullah is with someone else, he goes to that someone else. You know, knowledge doesn't know family or race or ethnicity or relationship, blood, يعني. It doesn't. That's why some of the ulama said, العلم شيء بعيد المرام لا يصاد بالسهام ولا يرى في المنام ولا يأخذ عن الأباء والأعمام. Said that علم is something, knowledge is something very far to reach. It is not to be seen in a dream, and it is not to be hunted with arrows, and it is not to be inherited from fathers and uncles. You have to seek it from wherever it is. So he is asking him, he said, أخبرني عن حجتي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقال بيده فعقد تسعة. He marked with his fingers nine. You know, nine with his fingers. The Arab used to make a symbol for every digit. I don't know them myself, all of them, يعني, but every single digit, thousands and thousands, with mark of their hands. So they will say like one, and they will, you know, say one, then two, then three, then four, then five, with the same hand. Now they're going to go like six, and then, you know, put seven, and then they put eight until, you know, they are 10. They will do like this. Then they will open one finger, and then they will close one finger. They will do certain things to show you the number. Right? So he said, he showed me with his hand, like nine. Like nine. He said, that means Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the ninth year, he stayed 9 years in Medina, did not do Hajj. Right? He said, Rasulullah stayed, and he marked 9 years in Medina, did not do Hajj. ثُمَّ أَذَّنَ فِي النَّاسِ فِي الْعَشْرِ. And in the 10th year, he announced. أَذَّنَ means he made an أذان, I mean announcement. In people that I am going to make Hajj this year. So before the Hijjah, few months before the Hijjah, he said, I am doing Hajj this year. But in the year 9, which many of the scholars, as we said last time, they said Hajj became fard on that year, right? Some of them said in the 6th, some of them said in the 9th, some of them said in the 10th. But Hajj became fard on the 9th. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu as the Amir of Hajj. He did not go himself, right? But he gave Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu the instruction how to do Hajj. And he did, right? That was not as precise as the 10th. But Muslims went to Hajj from Medina on the 9th. Because 8th was the Fath of Mecca. 8th, they opened Mecca. Now Mecca is under Muslimin. Right? So then the following year, Muslims made Hajj from all over Arabia. But in the 10th, Rasulullah said, I'm going myself. So Jabir said, people start flooding Medina. Because they want to go with Rasulullah. They could go from their place straight to Mecca and meet him there, but they want to observe. You see, that's the part. They want to come and observe with their eye from the time he leaves the masjid, what does he do? And they want to be part of it. Subhanallah. And that tells us also that how the Sahaba were eager to be part of the first of everything. You know, now people, you know, stand on the front of the Apple store for iPhone or for Samsung or whatever it is. How many people warned me not to say the brands in the lecture? But that's all right. Yeah. And how many people listen to my lectures anyways? they stand for in the line. And when you ask somebody, it's the whole idea, the concept of me holding the first thing. You want to be the one who did the history, like, I'm the first one who held that device. Which is okay, I understand that. But from concept point of view, Sahaba were doing that. Okay? Everything for them was the first. This ayah, first time it was recited, I was listening to it. Who can say that other than a Sahabi of Rasulullah? You see? You know, Hajj, I did with Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You know, I know every ayah. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud come and say, no ayah in Quran except I know where it was revealed, how it was revealed, when it was revealed, why it was revealed. Who can say that statement? Now we know who are the Sahaba, right? Now when you talk about Sahaba, I want you to remember these kind of things. We are nobody compared to them. So that's why we elevate them. It is not because they are not humans, no. Because they are special human beings that they came to the Rasulullah. So Jabir said, when Rasulullah made the announcement, قَدِمَ الْمَدِينَةَ بَشَرٌ كَثِيرٌ. Lots of people came to Medina. كُلُّهُمْ يَلْتَمِسُ أَنْ يَأْتَمَّ بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Everyone wants to observe and follow Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And from that, our concern should be always, especially for those who are going to Hajj, what do you want to do? What's your main concern? You want to do it right. Yes? Yeah, of course. We have no doubt that you are going to Hajj. Why you make all this effort? Why you spend all this money? Why you invest all this time? To seek the forgiveness of Allah. No doubt about that. Yes? To go for the sake of Allah and you want to come back forgiven. Yes? We agree on that one. But how are you going to get that? Doing it right. And those all these Sahaba, they come because they wanted to see Rasulullah. They wanted to see the second hand. That's why also it is very, very important that as you cared about all the logistics of Hajj, you should care about the religious aspect. You should be well educated before you go, know exactly what you're going to be doing and how you're going to be doing it. Now, you don't want to be, my brothers, I always advise, you know, people, I teach them about Hajj. You don't want to be a consumer over there for the religious fatwas. You want to be well up to the well-educated, know exactly what it is. I don't want you to say, huh, what, which one? I don't know, I'm confused. That means that you did not do your homework. Okay, please don't do that. If you don't leave other logistics to chance, don't leave your religion to chance either. You should know it and know it well. Okay, so when you go there, you'll find many opinions, people shooting things at you. Alhamdulillah, good. Jazakallah khair, thank you. I'm focused here, all right? So this is very important, you know, I tell people always, especially when you are an educated person, you are not a jahil, you are not ummi, you are not like a, you know, general who did not go to school or anything like that. You want somebody to imitate? No. You need to, you know, exactly know what you do. And that's what we try to do here, inshallah. So he said, فَخَرَجْنَا مَعَهُ. Now Rasulullah left Medina, حَتَّى أَتَيْنَا ذَا الْحُلَيْفَةِ. When you go to Medina, especially for those going to Medina first, you will see the Al-Hulayfa is about 15-minute drive from your hotel in Medina. This is the place where you do ihram. Of course, you're going to dress ihram from your hotel and all that. But the ihram, the actual ihram, starts from that point. Whether you go down or you don't go down, you're in the bus, or doesn't matter. All of these things are, you know, you know, but this is the point that you cannot pass without the niyyah of ihram for the umrah that you are going to do. So he's saying that, you know, حتى أتينا ذا الحليفة. So we came to the place called the الحليفة, or today called Abyar Ali, or the الحليفة. And there is a big, huge masjid. It's called Masjid al-Miqat. Miqat, right? So Miqat, Masjid, Zul Hulaifa, Abyar Ali, all same area. About 15-minute drive from, couple of miles, يعني, from the Masjid al-Nabawi. فولدت أسماء بنت عميس محمد بن أبي بكر. The wife of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, she gave birth in that time. يعني she was going with her due date. So she reached the الحليفة and she gave birth. To Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, she gave birth for his son Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. So Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr was born in the Miqat. فأرسلت إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كيف أصنع؟ What should I do now? Now I am in the postpartum, you know, bleeding. And so what should I do now? قال اغتسلي واستثفري بثوب وأحرمي. يعني he said, take غسل, bath, واستثفري يعني pad yourself, you know, padding, you know, like sanitary, you know, napkins and all that, so pad yourself. وأحرمي, and then do an intention like us, إحرام يعني. Only thing you cannot do is طواف and صلاة, بس, but everything else you can do, right? بثوب وأحرمي. That's you know, Jabir described that on the side يعني. فصلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في المسجد. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم prayed in the masjid. So if you have a chance to go inside the masjid and pray, whether it is a zuhr prayer, asr prayer, maghrib prayer, isha prayer, whatever prayer, pray that prayer and make ihram after, as we'll see in a minute. Or if it's not, pray two rak'ah, you know, nafil, sunnah, ihram, you know, and do the niyyah after. ثُمَّ رَكِبَ الْقَصْوَى. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ride his camel al-qaswa. And Rasulullah used to name everything he has. He names his camel, he names his mule, he names his donkey, he names his turban. Yeah, he have a turban called sahab, cloud. Yeah, he names his swords. Really? So it's a good thing, you know, he names. And that tells us how Rasulullah ﷺ interacted with everything around him. You know, give a name. Even he defend his camel when somebody talk bad about it. Wallahi akhwan. You see, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is giving us the highest example. When al-Qaswa one time sat and could not go, you know, did not want to move, so people said, oh, al-Qaswa is no good no more. He said, wallahi, it is good. This is not her behavior. She behaves better, but Allah is the one who ordered her not to move. You see, he defends a camel, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So it tells you, yani, how we deal with things we have. So he ride al-Qaswa, حتى استوت به ناقته على البيداء. So he made the niyyah. Now his camel is in the highway, يعني. He's like, خلاص, he's gonna go. نظرت إلى مد بصر. Jabir ibn Abdullah, the narrator, he says to the people now, he's teaching them, right? He's saying that at that time, I looked around me. Right? I looked around me. And on the right side, on the left side, on the front of Rasulullah, behind Rasulullah, I cannot see the end of people. That's how many people were around him. بين راكب وماشٍ. People who are walking, people who are riding, and they're surrounding Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. ورسولullah بين أظهرنا. He's in the middle. He's among us, and the Quran is revealed to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Quran is being revealed to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he knows the meaning of it, and is teaching it to us. Whatever he does, we imitated him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا عَمِلَ بِهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ عَمِلْنَا بِهِ. So he's saying, Rasulullah received the Quran, he teaches it to us, we act upon it without hesitation. That's it. فَأَهَلَّ بِالتَّوْحِيدِ. So Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did the talbiyah of monotheism. Why Jabir saying that? He said because there was talbiyah, but it has shirk in it. So Rasulullah said, لبيك اللهم لبيك. Here I come, ya Allah, here I come. لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك. Here I come, ya Allah, responding to you, no partner with you, and here I come. إن الحمد, truly all praise, والنعمة, all favors, لك, to you, والملك, all the dominion to you, لا شريك لك, no sharik to you. Until here, and he stopped, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. All mushrikeen used to do the same, but they add something else. Said, no partner with you, except the partner you allowed to be partner. You are the one who owns him, but he does not own you. You see, they make shirk. يعني. So Rasulullah stopped on the tawheed, and that's it. This talbi of Ibrahim alayhi salam, his grandfather. Okay? So he did that. So Jabir said, that was the first thing that they heard different now. Right? So he said, Ahalla bit tawheed. So now, inshallah, يعني, I'm going only to the description of the Hajj of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The ahkam or the rules, step by step, next week, inshallah. Alright? So يعني, don't worry about missing. We're just describing the Hajj of Rasulullah to have an image in your head. So he said another important point. He said, وَأَهَلَّ النَّاسُ بِهَذَا الَّذِي يُهِلُّونَ بِهِ. People say talbiyah, but in different moods. And Rasulullah did not stop them as long as they did not have any shirk. You know, some people said, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَسَعْدَيْكَ. You know, they add words, but all meaning the same, يعني. يعني, Allah, I'm coming. Allah, accept my hajj. You know, people say different du'as, يعني, different talbiyah, right? So Rasulullah led them, but he continued saying the same. لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. That's the talbiyah of Rasulullah from beginning to until he sees the Kaaba, as we'll see in a minute, right? So talbiyah all the time. Then he continued like that. Then Jabir said, we went with Rasulullah and our niyyah is Hajj. We did not know Umrah. What does that mean, we did not know Umrah? They knew Umrah, they did Umrah before. But what he means, in the time of Hajj, people never did Umrah until that year. Rasulullah is the first one who told them to do Umrah first. But in the months of Hajj, yani when Shawwal enters, Shawwal, you know, after Ramadan, Shawwal comes. Shawwal first, Eid al-Fitr, first day, until the ninth of the Hijjah, which is Arafah. Right? No Arab, nobody did Hajj. Nobody did anything at that time except Hajj. If they go with Ihram in Shawwal, they stay in the state of Ihram until the Hijjah. You get it, right? So he said, we did not know except Hajj. يعني أشهر في الحج الحج أشهر معلومات شوال ذي القعدة and the 10 days of the Hijjah, those are called the months of Hajj. So anybody goes at any of those days, what is their niyyah of ihram? Hajj, bas. That's what they know. And they considered Umrah to be like a major sin. يعني it is one of the worst thing to do Umrah at the time of Hajj. Is kind of like insult to Allah Azza Jal or something. That's how their aqidah, wrong, right? But that's how their, so Rasulullah changed that. As we'll see, that's why it was tough on them to accept it first. Was very tough to change that like that. So he said, we don't know what Umrah now? No. So everybody has intention for what? Hajj. And Rasulullah did not say anything. Just kept going, right? Gradually. يعني. So he kept going. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jabir said, until we reached the Kaaba. Of course, there are lots of events happened in the way. يعني. Maybe this is another time we talk about it. There are lots of lessons with the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because all of them were with him in Hajj. Huh? All the, you know, some fights happened, and you know, these nice things that we can learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One camel got lost, and Abu Bakr lost his food, and you know, he beat his servant. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Leave him," and then he found the camel coming. There are lots of stories, يعني, happened in the, along the way. Lots of nice, beautiful stories. So, Jabir here, he is cutting the long story short. So he said, until we reached al-bayt, and we saw the Kaaba, so al-labbayk, Allahumma al-labbayk, stops. So always you say al-talbiyah from the time you do ihram until the time you see Kaaba. That's for Umrah. For Hajj time, in the 8th, you start saying al-labbayk, Allahumma al-labbayk, until Jamarat day. On the 10th of the Hijjah. So 8th, 9th, Arafat, Muzdalifah, morning of Eid, once you throw the first stone, you say Takbir now. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, for 3 days after Eid. You got it? So Talbiyah, from the time you do ihram, you're going for umrah now, until you see the Kaaba, you stop talbiyah now. You only make the dua. Khalas? Fine? Then you finish your umrah and take off your ihram. When the 8th of the hijjah comes, you put ihram again and do hajj. Right? You keep saying labbaik Allahumma labbaik all the 8th, all the 9th, and part of the 10th until you go through the jamrat, you will talbiyah stop. We got that part, inshallah? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went to al-bayt al-haram. He said he went and he saw the Kaaba. He touched the rukn, يعني الحجر الأسود. He kissed it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he started his tawaf. Because you start from al-hajar al-aswad. And then he briskly made the tawaf in the first three tawafs. You have to do them in a brisk walk. We'll explain next week, inshallah. Brisk walk. And in a workshop, I will show the example. يعني. Right? If you can. If it is so crowded and tight, خلاص يعني, alhamdulillah. But if you have a space that you can shake your shoulders, men only, men only. Shake your shoulders and all of that, then you do it. And you uncover your right shoulder, which is outside. Not the one, you know, toward the Kaaba, but the one outside. You uncover it and bring it from under your armpit and go on the other shoulder. So the ihram, your shoulder shows, the men. And then you go brisk walk in the first, not jogging. Jogging is Safa Marwa, and it's coming. So there is walking, there is jogging, right? Jogging, like you jog, the base, your gait itself is jogging. But here you are not moving your feet from the ground. You are going like a little bit, you know, when you're walking faster. Brisk walk. Three times he did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he walked the other four. So three brisk walk and four regular. Then he went to Maqam Ibrahim. Maqam Ibrahim. Now you will find it is the golden dome away from the Kaaba. Maqam Ibrahim was stuck to the Kaaba at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the time of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab came, he removed it back. Why? Because people cripple everybody going around the Kaaba. Right, so he made that space. Now the same issue is happening. And the ulama was debating, should we move it even further or not? So he just left it as it is. Because people want to pray in there and they kind of become a hurdle in the tawaf flow. Yeah. So that's the reason it's separate from the Kaaba now. But it was actually part of the Kaaba. But you can imagine now people making tawaf and someone praying. And then it's hard for everybody to go around. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa went there and he stood facing the Kaaba and he recited the ayah of Allah وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى and pray at Maqam Ibrahim and he prayed two rak'ah. Jabir ibn Abdullah, he said he prayed behind the Maqam facing the Kaaba and he prayed in the first rak'ah قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ فَاتِحَ قُلْ يَا الْكَافِرُونَ second rak'ah قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ after Fatih. This is the sunnah, you know. Sunnah to do this two rak'ah like that. And why كافرون and كله الله واحد? If you think about it, you will find one is negating and one is affirming. One is saying there is no God to be worshipped and one saying Allah is the one who is worshipped. So this tawheed, you know, bringing your religion together to rak'ah while you are facing in the hajj, this is very important. Now, especially you are around the Kaaba. Some people say the Kaaba is from the stone and this stone and the black stone. So that's why in your salah, you said, I'm not worshipping these stones here. I'm just doing what Allah told me to do. So the point is not this stone building or this stone kissing. No, the point here is I'm obeying. That's why you are stating, قُلْ يَا الْكَافِرُونَ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. This is the one I came for. But this act is not intended for itself. These acts is just because Allah told me to do it, I'm not questioning. I'm just doing exactly what He told me. All right? Very important يعني, to get to that state of mind. Then Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam finished the seven and he prayed the two rak'ahs. Then he goes toward Safa. Of course, when you are in the tawaf, you will find after you finish, you know, last point is the first point. You start Hajar al-Aswad, you finish at Hajar al-Aswad. If you turn 180 degrees, you look in front of you, you find the gate of Safa. If you go straight, you will be at the mountain Safa. Very, you don't get lost there. So Hajar al-Aswad, if you turn around, you walk straight in a diagonal way, you're going to be at Safa. Easier. It's very, very simple. It's not like, well, where is Safa, Marwa? You don't have to do that. So this is one rule of thumb. You finish your tawaf, where is Hajar al-Aswad? You turn around, Hajar al-Aswad behind you, Safa will be right straight. Just like that. Okay? So he went to a Safa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he climbed Safa. How about you drink Zamzam in the way? Drink Zamzam in your way. Then he went to Safa, and he stood above it, faced the Kaaba, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, I will start with what Allah started with. What does he mean? When Allah revealed the ayah, he said, Inna Safa wal Marwata. So Safa came first, in the ayah. He said, I will start as the order of Allah Azza wa Jalla. He mentioned Safa before Marwa, then I should start from Safa. So he said, أَبْدَأُ بِمَا بَدَأَ بِهِ اللَّهِ. So he started with Safa. He climbed on it. And he looked at the Kaaba. Now it's very hard to see the Kaaba when you're in the Safa because there are levels and all of that. And then he said, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. And there are books of dua now, all of this written. أَنْجَزَ وَعْدَهُ. Allah fulfilled his promise. وَنَصَرَ عَبْدَهُ. And give victory to his servant, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, referring to himself. وَهَزَمَ الْأَحْزَابَ وَحْدَهُ. And he defeated all the confederates who came to attack Islam by himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah is not attributing himself, anything to himself, with human capacity. Everything, Allah is the one who fulfilled. That's important when you are in Hajj. When you are in Hajj especially, you have to learn how to attribute everything to Allah. Ya Allah, I'm here a slave. I'm nobody. Everything until this moment is from you and you alone. And everything from this point is from you and you alone. So please, Ya Allah, protect me and make me a good servant of yours. Wallahi, Ya Akhwani, I swear. If this becomes our state of mind, subhanallah, your hajj is accepted. And you are going to be straightforward until you die, inshallah. See, that's the whole idea of Hajj. I'm a slave. Ya Allah, until this point, everything I have, everything I do, I'm standing in front of you now, you. And everything from this point until I die is from you, Ya Allah. So please, Ya Allah, protect me and keep me in the straight path. You come back, mashallah. That's what Hajj is for. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Allah is the one who fulfilled his promise. Allah is the one who gave me victory. Allah is the one who defeated all the enemies. It's not me. Even though he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tears, blood, effort, everything. But when he attributes to who? Bas. Nah. Then after that, he made dua, Jabir said, and he said that he repeated that three times. And then he went down in the valley toward Al Marwa. That is his first round. So now after the dua and the safa facing the Kaaba, he went, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the Marwa. Until he became straight, because it is an incline, right? I mean, decline, coming down. And then he went, and when it became straight, he makes sa'i. Sa'i now is the jogging part, right? And now you will find two green lights marking that. And in between them, again, men only are the ones you're going to be jogging. And some narrations saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ihram, when he's jogging, is kept turning around. But to show, he showed his knees, even to, up to his knees. You know when you walk and you have like this izar, like a skirt, yani, it will keep turning around because it was, you know, on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like that. Then he went to Al-Marwa, he stood above it, he faced the Kaaba and repeated exactly what he said on Safa three times. And then he went back and he kept repeating that seven times. Seven times means you start with Safa, you're going to end with Marwa. It is not two rounds, one. It's not like that. From Safa to Marwa, one. From Marwa to Safa is number two. From Safa to Marwa, three. Four. So when you are going toward Marwa, you are odd number. And when you are going toward Safa, you are always even number. So that's why I tell people you will never lose count between Safa and Marwa if you're thinking properly. Because it's tough, tougher than tawaf. Tawaf circle, you can lose easy. You lose count easy, you know, because it's a circle. But when you're going back and forth, which one? Okay, am I going towards Safa or Marwa? Is odd number, and this is even number. oh, I have been going for this long, it has to be the fourth, you know. So it's okay. So you can get it easily between Safa and Marwa. So he did that 7 times, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. When he stood in the Marwa now, all the Sahaba is surrounding him. Now we finished Sa'i. What he's going to do, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now? Normally, before, they will do that and they will stay in their ihram until Hajj time. Whether it is 1 day or 1 month or 2 months. But now, that's why this is now an important point for them. What's new? So they are all now watching Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he waited because people are different pace, right? Some people start late, some people did. So he waited until everybody now at Al-Marwa. He said, لو أني استقبلت من أمري ما استدبرت لم أسق الهدي. If I can go back again in time, I would not bring the sacrificial animals with me. يعني الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم bring the camels and the sheep and all of that from Medina with him. Right? This was the habit of the Arabs. You know, people in Arabia, if they're going for Umrah or going for Hajj, they take the animals that they will slaughter with them and they mark it. That was a protection also for them. You know, if anybody meets them in the way, no thief, nobody can touch them. You know, because this is holy. Oh, this man is going for God. And these animals are going, oh, nobody should touch. Because they are afraid from any curse or anything like that. يسق الهدي. You know, هدي. Hadi, you know, in front of them. Oh, where is this going? Oh, this is the going for the Kaaba. You know, we slaughtered for Allah. Nobody. Let them go. You know, so Rasulullah ﷺ taking the hadi with him. Now, at the time of Marwa, he's standing there, he said, if I had a chance to go back, I would not bring hadi with me. وَجَعَلْتُهَا عُمْرَةً. I will get out of my ihram now and make what I just did now, عُمْرَةً, and stop here. So everybody says, عُمْرَةً? What? What عُمْرَةً? You know, عُمْرَةً now, this is like a big deal. So Rasulullah said, yeah, so he told everybody, فَمَنْ كَانَ مَعَكُمْ, whoever among you, لَيْسَ مَعَهُ هَدِي فَلِيحِلْ. Whoever did not bring hadi with him, take off your ihram, يعني means shave and that, and take off your ihram and be normal until the 8th of the Hijjah. Order straight, huh? So Suraqa ibn Malik, he stood up. Suraqa, the one who was running behind the Prophet, when he left Mecca and his horse sunk in the, you know that Sahabi, yeah? Yeah, he promised him the bracelets of Kisra. Right? So Suraqa, this man, he stood up. Subhanallah. Allah is the one who guides, right? You see who he was and what kind of question he's asking and where he's going to be later. So he asked Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, what you saying now, meaning يعني, whoever does not have hadi, make it Umrah, is only for this year or for years to come? Smart. Because he wants to know. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made his fingers like this. He said, دخلت العمرة في الحج. دخلت العمرة في الحج. Umrah now is in Hajj time. Right? They entered with each other. لا بل لأبد أبد. It is forever until يوم القيامة. So whoever does not have hadi from his place of origin coming to Mecca, you should do what? Tamattu'. What we call it Hajj Tamattu' now, right? Hajj Tamattu'. Tamattu' bil umrati ila al-hajj. Allah revealed that ayah later. Whoever make Tamattu' means you go do Umrah first, then you change and live your normal life until the 8th of the Hijjah comes, then you start Hajj. So in between Umrah, from the time you arrive in Mecca, and Hajj, there is a period. It doesn't matter how short or how long. Can be 1 hour, can be 1 day, can be 1 week, can be 1 month. Right? So those who go 10 days before Hajj, they make the Umrah and they have 10 days until 8th of the Hajj. Those who go on the 7th, they make Umrah and they overnight, and then the 8th, they make the Hajj. So at least there is a time that you take off your ihram and become normal. Yeah. Yeah, of course, as I said, you know, have to shorten or shave to get out of your ihram, of course. For men and for women, they clip, you know, one thumb long. As I said, inshallah, all these rituals we talk about, inshallah, in details. The next couple of weeks, inshallah. All right. So, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that. So now, those who had hadi, like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, stayed on their ihram, they did not shave or cut. Staying in ihram until the eighth. Right? Because their sacrificial animal with them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I don't have it, I would have taken off. So whoever did not have, take off. So the sahaba listened to Rasulullah. Those who have the hadi, stayed like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those who did not have the hadi, obeyed him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Come on, in the beginning, some of them did not accept it like this, and Rasulullah was afraid. Then he went to his tent and he told Aisha radiallahu anha, the Sahaba did not listen. She said, ya Rasulullah, do in front of, leave them and all of that. And then, Rasulullah advised them again, and they did it. Right? They did, they took off. And Ali ibn Abi Talib was in Yemen at that time. When he heard that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going for Hajj, he did not have a chance to go to Medina like everybody, then come to Mecca. Mecca is closer. He's coming from the south, right? So he's going to pass by Mecca. So what is the point of coming to Mecca, going to Medina, coming back to Mecca, right? So he met Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that. After he finished that tawaf and sa'i, Ali ibn Abi Talib arrived with camels, lots of camels, 100 camels he bring for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Rasulullah slaughtered by himself. For him, yeah. You see the barakah? So he wanted Rasulullah to slaughter 100 camels. Okay? So he bring, and then he come, Ali ibn Abi Talib, he looks for his tent, he finds his wife Fatima. But he finds she is dressed, she have kuhl, surma in her this, and she is, mashallah, dressed, like, what, you're not in ihram? This is strange for him, right? You are doing Hajj. He does not know this Umrah deal, right? He does not know Umrah deal. And he sees his wife like this. What is this? She said, my father did to order me. My father ordered me. He said, I ran to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to complain. What is this? What is this deal? This is new. I have to hear it from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, فذهبت إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم محرشا على فاطمة. I said, I found my chance now. I'm gonna get رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم to tell me what's wrong with her. So he goes to رسول الله and he said, يا رسول الله, I came from Yemen to do Hajj with you and find Fatima she's having this beautifying herself and all of this, and I kind of what is going on. صلى الله عليه وسلم, she said that my father told me. Did you tell her, يا رسول الله? He said, yes. صدقت صدقت. Truthful, يعني. What did you say, يا علي, when you coming from Yemen? What is your intention, يعني? Did you ask Allah for an intention? Or you did not do anything? He said, no, I did. He said, what did you say? He said, اللهم, O Allah, إني أهل, I make my intention, كما بما أهل به رسولك. Identical to the intention of your prophet. I don't know what's your intention. So I said, ya Allah, my intention is identical to the intention of your messenger. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I have hadi and you have hadi. We cannot make halal like this. We cannot take off. So you stay in your niyyah. You do tawaf and sa'i like, and you stay in ihram like us. Because you bring the sacrificial animals with you. I bring sacrificial animals with you. But Fatima and all others did not bring. So they took off their ihram. So he brought 100 camels, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And we'll see, inshallah, he slaughtered them later. And he feed all the people in Mecca, يعني, طبعاً, of course, the poor people in Mecca, he feed. So when the 8th of the Hijjah came, طبعاً, Rasulullah came to Mecca, and he stayed there 4 days. So he came like in the 3rd or the 4th of the Hijjah, right? He did all this. And then those who did not have the sacrificial animals, now they are tamattu. And those who have like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they stayed in their ihram for 4 days, right? Until the 8th day of the Hijjah comes. Now, 8th of the Hijjah comes while you are in Mecca, you don't have to go out or miqat or anything like that. You make ihram from your hotel, from your room, from your place. Say, put ihram and say, labbaik Allahumma hajj, hajj, right? You go. When you come from Medina, say, labbaik Allahumma umrah, right? Umrah. So, umrah finished. Now, 8th of the Hijjah comes. He made that niya sallallahu alayhi wasallam, made a hajj, and he went to dhuhr time. He entered Mina, dhuhr. Eighth of the hajj. He prayed there dhuhr, asr, maghrib, isha, and fajr of the ninth. Fajr of the ninth, the day of Arafah. And then he moved to Arafah. So he prayed dhuhr, asr, maghrib, isha, and fajr. Five prayers, starting with dhuhr, finishing with fajr. If you can't do that, this is okay. Yani sometimes you're going to go to Mina early, sometimes you're going to go to Mina late, sometimes you arrive at Arafat early, sometimes you arrive at Arafat late, no big deal, yani, right? But we're just saying what happened. then he waited in Mina until the sun rose, and then he asked for a tent from hair, the animal hair, yani, sha'ar, of the goats. There are suf of the sheep, there are sha'ar of the goat, and there are wabar of the camel. And all the three types of skin, they used to make tents out of it. Right? So they have this wabar, bait wabar, يعني the as Allah said من أسوافها وأوبارها وأشعارها أثاثا ومتاعا إلى حين سورة الأنعام الأعراف. So Allah عز you know they used to do this, the camel skin and make it a tent. It has certain characteristics that help with the rain, with the you know it has يعني certain characteristics. So the hair has certain characteristics and the wool of the sheep has certain characteristics. They use it for war, for summer, for winter, for desert, for this, you know, they have different use for it. So Rasulullah ordered قبة من شعر, يعني a tent like a dome made of the hair, means the goat, يعني skin. In Namira, you know, in Arafat, there is Masjid Namira. Masjid Namira is not part of Arafat. Okay? It is outside of Arafat. The end of the Masjid is in Arafat. يعني the end of the masjid, the expansion of the masjid, they expanded the masjid, that the last two, three lines of it is in Arafah. But all the masjid not in Arafat. And that's why they make the khutbah of Arafah in Namira. So some people think that they are standing in Arafah when they are in masjid in Namira. But they are not standing in Arafah. That's why many people, they want to go masjid in Namira when we are standing in Arafah. Right? We tell them, make sure you go visit the masjid, but Maghrib doesn't come while you are in the Masjid al-Namr, because you are not standing in Arafah, and all of this means nothing if you are not standing in Arafah, right? Hajj Arafah, right? So that's why many people, out of jahl or ignorance, they go stay in the Masjid al-Namr and they forget about it, right? They think that they are in Arafah, but Masjid al-Namr is not in Arafah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered that tent to be made in Namr. All Quraysh, they thought that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم will stand on the ninth in Muzdalifah, because that's what Quraysh used to do. They said everybody stand in Arafah, but we are special elite, we stand in Muzdalifah. They changed the root rituals of Hajj. Discrimination, يعني, right? We are Quraysh. Let everybody stand in Arafah, but we stand in Muzdalifah. So Quraysh said, oh, no way, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, well, no way, he is going to go to Arafat like everybody else. He will respect the tradition of his forefather. So while he was in Namira, they think that he's going to go to Muzdalifah now, right? And abandon Arafat. Let everybody stand in Arafah, but he will go like his family. Tradition, stand in Muzdalifah like they used to do in Jahiliyyah. Right? but Rasulullah moved after Zuhr and he entered Arafah. He did not go to Muzdalifah. حتى أتى عرفة. He came to Namira, and till, you know, after Zuhr, then, you know, he told Al-Qaswa, the camel, to ask for the camel, and it was prepared. Then he went to the valley, and he gave the khutbah for people, which we know the khutbah of Arafat, right? And he stood there, and he told the people the following. إِنَّ دِمَاءَكُمْ your blood, وَأَمْوَالَكُمْ your money, your wealth, وَحَرَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ it is prohibited for to take from each other, you know, without right. كَحُرْمَةِ يَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا it is sacred as the sacredness of this day. As how this day is sacred, the day of the ninth. فِي شَهْرِكُمْ هَذَا this is the month of the Hijjah, sacred month. في بلدكم هذا, this is a secret city, right? ألا كل شيء من أمر الجاهلية تحت قدمي موضوع. All the affairs of jahiliya is under my feet now. Means have no value for me. And then he gave two examples. ودماء الجاهلية موضوعة. All these blood feuds, who kill, have to kill from them, you know, these blood feuds. First thing I put under my feet. أول دم and the first blood I forgive today from jahiliya is دم ابن ربيعة ابن الحارث. You know, ربيعة ابن الحارث. الحارث is the uncle of Rasulullah, الحارث ابن عبد المطلب. ربيعة is the cousin of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم in jahiliya. He was a child في بني سعد. There is a tribe called بني سعد. حليمة السعدية, the one who gave breastfed Rasulullah, is from that tribe. And that tribe was like kind of Quraysh, you know, give their kids to be raised in there. So some people attacked Bani Sa'd and killed Rabia, killed the child. Now this child belongs to who? Bani Hashim, the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So according to the traditions of the Arabs, they have to kill someone from that. And that was like kind of a code. If it has to happen, right? So everybody's like waiting for it. Even Islam came and all that, you know, somebody is going to kill somebody from us. And now they are all Muslimin, right? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, all these blood feuds in Jahiliyyah stops right here. Khalas, forgiven. All this deal out. Now we start from beginning now. If somebody kill, is the shara of Allah will be applied. It's not the tradition and the code of the family and all of that. You get it? So he said, first blood is ours. He has to start with himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, you know, I am the one now. My family, I start with my family first. Anybody has blood feud has to do the same. So I'm starting first. That's number one. Now this is the blood, huh? Now comes to the money. Because Rasulullah said, your money is sacred, your blood is sacred, right? So now he has to start with himself. Blood is sacred. Nobody can kill anybody from the Jahiliya history. And I start with myself. How about the money? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَرِبَ الْجَاهِلِيَّ مَوْضُوعِ. Riba, usually. Also, خلاص. If you give loan to somebody and you're charging riba, did you get equal to your capital? Alhamdulillah. You did not equal to get your capital, get equal to your capital. And there is no more interest. Right? You, that's it. And the first riba is the riba of my uncle right here, Al-Abbas. Abbas was a very wealthy man, and that's one of his businesses. He gave people loans and he charged them interest for it. He said, I start with my uncle today. No riba. You see, he started with himself. It's very hard. It's very hard. It's very easy to stand in the member here and tell people what to do. It's the easiest thing. But it is the hardest thing to start with yourself. You know, it's tough. It's tough because everybody looks at you. Is he doing that? Or is he not doing that? What is the deal here? So he started with himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he started with, now after those two rules, the blood and the money, and giving example with himself, role modeling, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he do? He asked about women. He took care of the women. He said, اتقوا الله في النساء. Be careful and fear Allah in your wives. You took them with the trust of Allah. بأمان الله استحللتم فروجهن بكلمة الله. You became intimate with them with the word of Allah. Became halal for you. ولكم عليهن ألا يطئن فروشكم أحدا تكرهونه. Your duty upon them, your right upon them, that they do not bring anyone without your permission to your home, especially those you don't like. That means you have to ask permission. And then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said how you deal with the wives, you know, advice and all of that, and you know, give them the drink and the food and the shelter. And then he said, I left among you what you, if you hold to, you will not go astray, the book of Allah. And if you will be asked about me. Rasulullah said, Allah will ask you about me. فَمَا أَنْتُمْ قَائِلُونَ. What would you say when Allah asked about me if I deliver the message? They all said, نَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ قَدْ بَلَّغْتَ وَأَدَّيْتَ وَنَصَحْتَ. You give the balag, you told us, and you delivered the message, and you advised us, Ya Rasulullah. So they said, so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raised his finger, and he said, اللَّهُمَّ فَشْهَدْ. اللَّهُمَّ فَشْهَدْ. اللَّهُمَّ فَشْهَدْ. You know, this means, Ya Allah, be witness on them. See, he asked them, did I deliver? Said yes. He said, Ya Allah, be my witness on them. Be my witness on them. Be my witness on them. Three times. It's very tough, huh? Then Rasulullah said, Adhan. Then Adhan came and make Iqama, and he prayed Zuhr, then another Iqama, he prayed Asr. And then he did not pray any Sunnah in between, and then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam moved to Arafah now. So all of this out of Arafah. Zuhr, Asr, out of Arafah, then he entered Arafah, where now they call Jabal al-Rahma, right? You know, the mountain of mercy. That's where he stopped sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then there are some few rocks there, so he made the qaswa or the camel there, and he was riding on it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he faced the qibla, and he stood there until the sunset, making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the maghrib time came. Then he put Usama bin Zayd behind him, and then he pulled the rope for the camel all the way to him. What does that mean? Means the camel's neck was like this. So it does not speed. يعني. Right? Because you know people are rushing. So if he leaves the rope, the camel moves fast. He pulls the rope, the camel slows down. So it's chanaq al-qaswa. It was very tight toward him. So it moves slowly. And he was waving with his right hand to the people and telling them, As-sakina, as-sakina, tranquility, tranquility, ease. Because everybody was rushing toward Muzdalifah, right? As-sakina, as-sakina, take it easy, tranquil, tranquil. Whenever he reaches a hill, he gives the rope a little bit to the camel so it goes to the incline. And whenever it's coming down, he pull it, you know, Jabir mentioned that until he reached Muzdalifah, he prayed Maghrib and Isha with one Adhan and two Iqama, right? He reached Isha time, يعني. So in Arafah, Dhuhr and Asr at the time of Dhuhr. In Muzdalifah, Maghrib and Isha at the time of Isha, right? So you see, so you have Ibadah and all of that in between and the Dua. Once he reached the Mash'ar al-Haram, which is a place in Muzdalifah, he slipped. He slept, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, gathered the stones, and after that, Maghrib al-Isha slept. When he woke up, prayed Fajr in al-Mash'ar al-Haram. There is a mosque there called Masjid al-Mash'ar al-Haram. And then he stood there, made the dua, and the La ilaha illallah, and the talbiyah, until the, you know, light, not the sunrise, but light came. And then, you know, he went before sunrise, and he put behind him now Al-Fadl ibn Abbas. So Usama bin Zayd from Arafat to Muzdalifah. Now Fadl ibn Abbas, his young cousin, from Muzdalifah to Mina. And Al-Fadl was a very handsome young man. Very handsome. So he was with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the camel, and he has very nice hair. طبعاً in the Hajj, you don't put anything on your head, right? So he's very handsome and very young and long hair. And then Rasulullah, يعني Jabir says, some young women passed in front. So Al-Fadl used to look at them. So Rasulullah sallam moved his face. You know, he's looking at him, and Rasulullah sallam with his hand moved the face. So Al-Fadl look on the other side, he moved his face the other side. And Rasulullah sallam kept doing this to Al-Fadl ibn Abbas. Until the women passed away. And he reached to a place called Batn Muhassir. So he moved very fast. This is where the Abraha and his people were punished by the stones. So Rasulullah ﷺ moved fast through that road. And then he reached to Al-Jamra Al-Kubra, the major Jamra, which is closer to Mecca. Major Jamra, which is closer to Mecca. This is the one you do on the 10th. Later, you start with the small one, middle one, then big one. The 3 days, other 3 days. But Yom Al-Eid, you only throw Jamrat al-Aqaba, which is side of Mecca. But from Mina, you come to the small one first, then the middle one, then the big one, right? You understand? But in the Eid day, you don't do that. You go straight to the big one. And the roads will be only open to the big one anyways. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he went there and he threw 7 stones. He make takbir with everyone. Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar, 7 times, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Small, like a chickpea size. Then after that, he went to Al-Manhar, which is a place for they used to have for slaughtering. فَنَحَرَ 63. How many camels Ali ibn Abi Talib brought? 100, huh? He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, slaughtered 63 only. Because he was 63 years old. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one for every year of his life. And then he gave the knife to Ali to finish the rest. Subhanallah, as he knows that this is his last year, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 63 and he stopped. And that was his last year, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So nahr is stabbing, you know, nahr for the camels, slaughtering for the other animals, and aqr for hunting. So there are three ways to make the halal, yani. So he made that. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered the sahaba to take a piece from each camel, small piece of meat, and he put it in one big pot, right? And, you know, from that he drank some soup and he ate little piece. Sunnah, yani, from that, and everything else for everybody. Yani, sadaqah for everybody. So he ate from its meat and he drank from its soup. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ride his camel and he went straight to the Kaaba. He made the tawaf and he prayed zuhr in Mecca. And then he found the people are doing in Zamzam. His family, yani, from Abdul Muttalib, he said, you know, bring the buckets of water. He said, if I'm not afraid that people will imitate me, I would have pulled the bucket with you. But he said, you know, give me the bucket, yani, give me to drink. And he asked them to give him to drink. He said that if I'm not afraid, if I go now and pull the bucket with you, everyone wants to pull the bucket. Then, you know, people will say, no, Bani Abdul Muttalib cannot be in charge of Zamzam now. You see? So Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, you keep doing your job, because it was an honor for them to drink, to give drink to everybody. It was honor, right? Like the honor for Bani Abdul Dar to be the one who taking care of the Kaaba, putting perfume on it, you know. He doesn't want anybody to do like that. So Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam honored them. He said, the key for you, nobody takes it to you except from Zalim. That's why until now, those who have the key for the Kaaba is from the same family. A king or anybody cannot enter the Kaaba without their permission. Because Rasulullah said, it's yours till the day of judgment. Nobody will take it except the Zalim. So Zamzam also is charged of Bani Abdul Muttalib, and the people, the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I don't want people to, you know, disturb you, so you continue that. And he drink from it, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So this is the hadith of the Hajj of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in general. Inshallah, next time we are going to briefly talk about some lessons from this hadith, and then we will go to the rituals. Now the formal part or the ahkam part, the sharia part, what are the ihram, the miqat, what to say, what not to do, all of these things will go step by step the following, inshallah, week or two. Then after we finish, we'll have that four-hour workshop on a Saturday, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. We'll announce it, inshallah, next week. That we'll have, inshallah, you know, a good, nice program here with presentations and everything for the Hajj. It will be three sessions, so be ready for it, inshallah. Three sessions. The first session will be about the logistics and how to prepare yourself to go. And the second one will be the rituals of Hajj again. And the third one will be the spirituality of Hajj and what you need to bring back with you, inshallah. May Allah accept from those who are going. May Allah, inshallah, give the ability for those who want to go to go. And for those, inshallah, who did not have the chance, let Allah give them the barakah and give them the chance to go, inshallah. Sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi. Jazakumullahu khairan.